Welcome to Channel 70 and this SOA special. The SOA team is delighted to bring you magic moments of this 70th anniversary year in the SOA's club history. Yes, magic moments. Or were they magic? Or were they just like the moments of any of the 70 years in the club's history? Wait as this story unfolds. We start with a picture. Is it SOA? In bloom.
...2003 has been a spectacular year for SOA. Anniversaries like catches overflowing. The 100th year of our founder's birth. The 70th anniversary of the club's formation. And the 50th year since Barry Bacon first came on tour. Many would say, cause for celebration. Well, some of us did celebrate, thanks to Admiral Cunningham, by voyaging back through 250 million years of geological time along Devon's Jurassic coastline. En route to the tour match at Sidmouth, we took a boat. What, by comparison, is a mere 70 years, best symbolized by the denaturing of an SOA cap? Well, everything. The vision and practice of friendly cricket, expounded by our founder Malcolm Elwin, have taken root and grown from about 30 to over 500 members today, and initially 10 to now nearly 50 annual fixtures, thanks to the club's officers. A skeptic might say, pull the other one. Club cricket lives by one word alone, league. If, however, we open a pre-publication copy of the 2004 Wisden, already a collector's piece, the pages record a very different picture, starting with the expressed views of three elder statesmen.
Would Malcolm Elwin be pleased with it? With it now, I think in the modern way of cricket, the answer is yes. Certainly, in some ways, standards have slipped. But when we look around us and hear and see what is going on, we are very glad that the SOA can still play both to the laws of cricket and to the spirit of those laws. Very important, both.
I think it's wonderful that the club has continued with the traditions that Malcolm Elwin set out for 70 years and played their matches in the true spirit of cricket. And I'm sure that he would be very appreciative of what the members have done to carry on the good work that he started.
In founding the SOA, he made, for the great benefit of all of us since, the decision to call his side, when he founded it in South Oxfordshire, the Amateurs. And the word amateur was particularly chosen as indicating the fun in playing the game.
What do the events and magic moments have to tell the reader in response to our arch skeptic? Well, starting with the Oxford-based season. In preparation, the indoor nets at Lord's met the needs of some members. Likewise, the art exhibition of George Hughes Games featured Ludgrove Cricket Pavilion. There were other surprises too. Despite the sun, 9 games were lost, either through trying to play on pitches in the floodplain during May, and yes, even in late June, and occasionally relentless rain. Was this yet another false trail laid for those geographers and politically correct journalists who would have us believe that climate change is a fact? When, however, eventually the flag was raised, there were some exciting matches and colourful performances. These included 4 centuries, two 6-plus wicket hauls. There were 2 nail-biting finishes. The first against Aylesbury Town, as Russell Hayes will explain.
Things changed when the Buckingham Pro, an ex-Australian crusader, blasted 81 of 47 balls. This included seven sixes, mostly off Chris Drake's, into the housing estate next door. Nearly resulted in the game being ended because we lost six balls and there were hardly enough balls on the ground to continue with the game. Philip Scott caught a shell of a catch mid-off, off a full toss. And then the low-order batsman took him to within striking distance, but Richard Scott's off-spin took us to the end and we were able to bowl them out four short in the last over.
The second was at Winchcombe, when the Gloucester Gypsies, with two wickets in hand, were kept at bay from reaching the target of 288.
Some really special performances. Alec Cunningham hit a tremendous 100, a really class act. It is a small ground, but a 100 against the Gypsies is great stuff. Other highlights, both Mark Wingfield Digby and Paul Hebbert batted well, and extras were a big highlight in our innings. 62 of them out of 288. They got to 200 odd for two, and we looked in serious trouble. Luckily, we had our two serious stock bowlers bowling at that stage and with enough energy left in them to complete the innings. Closing overs, most exciting. Alec Cunningham and Paul Hebbert were the bowlers and were doing a very good containing couple of spells. The batsmen were getting in increasing trouble. The fielding improved, but their invalid batsman, coming in at number eight, I think, almost got them out of the hole they dug themselves, and he made 25 not out. That left them, I think, wanting four off the last ball, and they got one. They're always good value, the Gypsies.
Off the pitch, there were some particularly memorable moments when laughter and the love of friends were in abundance. For example, at the post-match barbecues at the Downs, the Teddies and Brasenose grounds, the delicious teas regularly provided, one occasion by three generations of ladies related to our honourable member for OUP. Bloxham, where we helped to drain the local dry. Thanks to the candid cameras, answers were also provided for those inquisitive about what do players do beyond the boundary. Whitney Mills, where Ted Sandbach was raised from slumber by simulated specks of rain. And then Luke and Danny Boy increased their annual payments to Denplan. Victories were only occasional. One was recorded against Abingdon Vale on a particularly hot day in August, just before the end of the Oxfordshire-based fixtures.
I won the toss and was given the choice to have a bat, and we managed to get 223 for seven, which was not a bad score. In behalf of myself getting a half century, support then came from Martin Fennell, who also scored 70. Simon Dickens chipped in with some runs, so did APW, Tim Senior and then Harvey as well. We managed to reduce them to 32 for four at tee. Early wickets coming from Simon Dickens and myself really put them on the back foot. It kept taking regular wickets, Den Harvey and APW both picking up three wickets apiece. It was a very comfortable win. I believe we won by 50 runs.
However, for Ellie Wilson, clearly the best moment was Dad's arrival off the field. It would be wrong to conclude that this and other gains experienced were all pain and frustration free. We witnessed toe damage at Turville Park in the case of both Dan O'Sullivan and George Lamb. For some, batting and bowling were frustrating. Finally, poor Richard sustained a horrible injury at Ascot Park. Consumer research also revealed that tastes in reading material had not really changed from previous seasons, as shown by Dick Giles' lurkers and Mark Wingfield Digby. The President's match, played on a wicket requiring delayed response from the batsman, was intended to provide pre-tour practice for members travelling to Australia in February.
We only managed to muster 134 all out in 40-ish overs.
Thanks to accurate bowling by Doc, Simon and APW.
Paddy and Chris Hutton opened the batting, and Chris Hutton took a particular liking to my bowling and they raced off very quickly. Four wickets did fall for virtually no runs at all, 4 for 44 I think they were at one stage.
Thereafter, Paul Hebbett, Tim Sutton and Ian Campbell affected the coup de grace.
Unfortunately the game finished rather early, but that was good in so far as we managed to get in the bar nice and early and the drinking time was lengthened considerably.
Perhaps the most memorable moment of the day was the first boundary circuit made by SOA's youngest potential recruit, James Lunn. Then we come to the South Western Tour, the second of the major activities of the season.
Well, sitting here at North Devon, the SOA is one of only two clubs who were touring down here before the war, and still are.
Surprise results were also a main feature of this year's Southwestern Tour, which centred initially on the 16th century coaching inn, the Globe, at Topsham. Novelties this year included Barry Bacon's 50th year on tour, the umpiring and scoring contributions of John and Di Wadsworth, first-time attendances by Alec Cunningham, Simon Ray with family, and Den. The presence of three playing members of the Wakefield family, proudly supporting an age range of more than 50 years. Of the first six matches played, four were lost and two drawn, such that we entered the second week without recording a victory. There were many moments of both ecstasy and agony during the 12 days. At Taunton Deane, both Michael Wingfield Digby and Jim Head scored half century.
Shot.
Supported strongly by Richard Allen and Scotty.
Lottery declared a tee. Paul Humphreys and Den Harvey both picked up two. They totaled 219 for eight. Rob Down picked up 70 runs at 60 balls. The number three, the President, went in and hit a very big hitting, 20 or so. And Andy Smith was out in the penultimate over for 47. And with the SOA only needing 18 off the last over, Ottery just about held on. Den Harvey picked up 14 of those and a couple of extras, and again, just three short off the last at the end of the innings. We actually came closer to winning than anybody but the umpire knows, in that three balls from the end off byes, the ball came within 1 inch of hitting one of the Ottery St Mary's protectors, and clearly we would have won the game if that had happened.
At Exmouth, Rob Dow and Andy Smith were again the leading run-getters. Alec Cunningham and James Hall provided the principal supporting cast. The first agonies were experienced initially by Richard Weston from some hostile bowling, and then by the whole team due to the onslaught by a powerful Australian pro.
Sidmouth's always quite a special match to play in, being a fantastic ground, but this year was different with Alec Cunningham being keen to reenact a scene from Dunkirk with a beach landing, so quite a few of our team arrived by ferry. In my panic of trying to get the players sorted and having two late arrivals, I omitted to nominate anyone to actually keep wicket, so we wandered out on the field, got halfway to the square before Richard Weston turned around to me and said, "Who's keeping Skip?" It's
despite Richard Weston being press ganged into keeping wicket, he actually did very, very well with two catches and a stumping. They won the toss and chose to bat on a fairly indifferent wicket. We bowled well with Paul Humphries and James Hall starting off very well. Sidmouth made 206 for 9. Steve Wilson had got 4 wickets. Roger Berryman bowled very well. Dick Giles bowled very well. In fact, all the SOA bowlers bowled very well. SOA batted, and again we were led from the front by Big Rob, who scored a very good 50, batted for a good 40 odd overs. Without a great deal of support, only Richard Weston and Alec Cunningham showed any real signs of resistance. As we all know as batsmen, to be out first ball is never nice. To actually have an entry in a primary club in 2 successive innings on your first ever tour tends to be slightly embarrassing and very expensive. But I think most of the team were fairly pat on the back. Bad luck, Simon. Better luck next year. We fell short of the Sidmouth total by 37 runs. We did put up a fairly good fight, but they were a bit too strong for us. But you can never really complain when you play at a ground like Sidmouth. We always have a great day.
Additional attractions were provided both for the spectators and by. Local croquet players as a foretaste of the more primitive games played at the Hartnell later in the tour, courtesy of Barry Bacon's Headlights. At Showbrook, Matty Lee and Andy Smith, along with the skipper Paul Hebbett, made our response to the Dumplings' total of 293 for 8 declared look respectable. A cameo contribution from Doc of 37 in as many balls raised our expectations at one stage.
Prominent players first week were Andy Smith for his wicket keeping. Main strike bowlers, well, if you call it strike bowling, Tony Lurcock, James Hall, Scotty Akers, Den Harvey and Steve Wilson bowling his slow spin. Runs were shared around mostly between the whole side, but Jim Head, he certainly scored quite a few runs. The decisions that Jim had seemed to give him a lot of anguish with regards to returning to the pavilion. Thus his rendering of the LBW blues added a special touch of poignancy.
Other local delights during the week included the Italian and Galleon restaurants and, for some, the RSPB Nature Reserve. For the majority of members, the Hartnell Country House Hotel was home for the second week.
The pitch this year was quite lively, actually. In the past, it's been a very slow, fairly dead pitch, but on this occasion, we were met with balls coming at us in all different heights and levels. But we know Ian of old. I mean, he speaks his mind. He went in and opened, and he got balls flying around his ears. So he called for his helmet, which is quite strange, really, in friendly cricket. But he got one that kept low and was bowled out. We'd actually lost 4 wickets at lunchtime, a score of 68 for 4.
As always, lunch was one of the gastronomic delights of the week, providing David Money with a popular photo parade opportunity.
This new, rather magnificent pavilion here.
When we went out after lunch, we did improve slightly, and Paddy, especially, and yours truly, managed to get the score beyond the 100. Paddy, as you know, caresses the ball, and we got to a total which we were not happy with, but we thought we could actually defend on the line. We actually tried 8 different bowlers. Didn't work. They deserved to win. They played far better on their own pitch.
At the end of the day, I would just like to say to the groundsman, next time he prepares this pitch, to use a rotavator and plant carrots at one end and potatoes at the other. That's Ian Corns, SOA, Chumley.
The bank holiday match, the first one. Barry Bacon led the side in his 50th year for the club on tour. SOA were a little short on the bowling side and required a wicketkeeper to bowl in tandem with Johnny Campbell. So Dave Jones and Campbell bowling in tandem managed to restrict the North Devon side to about 250. In reply, there were good contributions from Chris Wakefield Sr., Russell Hayes, Hugo Cobham, and Johnny Campbell. And with little Chris Wakefield Jr. also providing the SOA with some runs, he was enthusiastically applauded for his innings. Bacon then ensured that although the SOA were 50 runs short in the end, they certainly weren't going to give North Devon a victory, and he managed to block out the last few overs.
Before dining in the pavilion, we enjoyed the display of the groundsman's skills entailed in maintaining the club's long famous square and ground.
Main features of the second game were the game started a little late owing to a little bit of rain. Having won the toss and duly elected to bat, the SOA opened with Rafe and Hugo Cobham, who steadily put on a good 50 partnership. And with a dashing 83 from Simon Wakefield, this allowed the SOA to declare at about 210, which looked a fairly decent total. Until the Australian pro for the North Devon side opened the innings and promptly dispatched the SOA bowling to all parts prior to tea. Once tea was taken, Noxie comes on after tea, and the Australian then decided that he was going to work singles. What we didn't quite work out was whether Noxie was bowling very well or he was under instructions to make sure that the game got into the last 20 overs. We do suspect that it might have been the latter. Anyway, the game finished early with about 7 overs to go, and at least it allowed us to get into the bar and have some nice sociable drinks, followed by the Chinese meal at the Hancock.
Game at Tiverton in the delightful setting there brought two very much contrasting sides, a very youthful Tiverton Heathcote and a somewhat geriatric SOA side. However, the pitch at Tiverton was much more to Ian Corns' liking than it was at Chumley the day before. Chris Wakefield put on a very quick start and was soon out. And then Ian Corns and myself managed to put on a century partnership with Ian, I think, scoring 80 in a superb knock, and various other people contributed. And I think the SOA reached 206 for 7. And then in reply, we looked like suffering a 9-wicket defeat after a very good start from John Campbell, pegged them back somewhat, and then, however, the change bowlers came on and we were struggling somewhat. However, Barry Bacon performed a mammoth spell for Barry, taking 4 wickets, and even myself managed to chip in with 2, and at one stage we looked like we just might be sneaking home a victory with a tremendous catch from the president at first slip. A quicker ball from myself plucked it out of thin air. However, Simon Wakefield came in for Tiverton and produced the goods for them, and unfortunately we lost by 3 wickets. However, we did get to the last over and lost off the last ball. A tremendous day's cricket, however, the result was the wrong way.
During the croquet and pool later that evening, it was realised that with only 2 games left, we had still not achieved a win. It was mooted, such was the concern, that the tour would have to continue for a third week. the side only being allowed to return home once a victory had been achieved. Whereupon, one nameless wag commented that we might not actually reach home until Christmas. The match against Chagford on the edge of Dartmoor National Park provided an opportunity.
I won the toss and I elected to bat. And that seemed a good idea after Rob Flory and Jim Head had put on 130 for the opening stand, particularly as their professional and one-time international spin bowler was on. After that, though, things didn't look so good when the remaining batsman only added 68 runs and I declared roughly about half-time on 198 for 6.
In reply, Chagford wickets fell in quick succession, thanks to
some really good use of a helpful pitch by James Hall. Ian Ramsey at the other end bowled very tightly, and that was really important in that game, where if they'd have got away, then I think they'd have torn off. And then he was backed up by Roger, and Roger came on and tempted them, and was able to make the breakthroughs, which actually enabled us to bowl them out. Christopher Wakefield bowled two tight overs for only one run. But he did it well, and he certainly made one of them move very sharply. It was really good to get a victory, really good for the tour, and we played well that day.
Great jubilation erupted from all corners of the ground as Ian Ramsey took the final catch off Roger's bowling. Week 3 could now begin. Constant rain overnight decided that despite bright sunlight, SOA aspirations and exertions, the tour would end on the Chagford Howe. And now attention is turning to the Australian tour. Yes, we are greatly looking forward to it and to visiting the home of the Don.
I've never played cricket abroad before and I'm looking forward to the challenge of batting on harder, faster wickets against a more aggressive type of cricketer.
We will have to play a lot better than in the President's match.
If we carry on playing like that, Rafe, the consequences will be bankruptcy by the amount of Forex we shall all have to buy.
That is never in danger, because as these highlights have indicated, our founder, in his wisdom, seemed to design the SOA with an almost indefinable product in mind. It's captured by a single word, magic.